This is the way.
This is the way.
This is the way.
Hey, gang, welcome to another roundtable discussion. Oh, I'm so glad we're back on The Mandalorian. This week, we're talking Chapter 9, The Marshal, and I am here with my three favorite co-hosts, as always, starting off with my good friend and yours, Scott Clark. Scott, how are you today, my buddy?
I'm doing great, guys. Ready for another season.
Are you happy to be back in the studio?
Yep. Looking forward to it and enjoy it.
This is going to be great. I'm so looking forward to the season. Also joining us today is Justin. Justin, how are you?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you doing, Stan?
I am awesome as always, but you already knew that.
I did already know that.
And from the original Grand Circle Tour co-host team, Jason. Jason, how are you today, my friend?
Bright suns, everyone. I am fantastic. And to quote Han Solo, didn't we just leave this party?
Yeah, no kidding. I'm so pumped. Mandalorian's back. I like doing like a recap type show. I could have talked about this beforehand, but let's go beat by beat through the series and kind of pick up on highlights that we want to see. Starting off with the recap. Oh, before we get into it too much, if you haven't watched Chapter 9, Marshall, you may not want to listen to this show because we're going straight into spoilers. We're not going to joke around with non-spoilers and then get into spoilers. We're straight into spoilers. So this is your spoiler alert. If you haven't watched it yet, pause it. Watch it. It's on Disney Plus. And then come back and we'll talk about it. So the introduction, the recap from last season, was there anything in particular that stood out to you guys?
I liked the way they did it. They rearranged some of the events a little bit in terms of how they hit the different clips from last season, but it explained everything very well, I thought. It was a good way to get really caught up really quickly on the major story points.
Yeah. And I'm assuming all three of us pretty much rewatched all of season one before we dove into season two. Scott, did you rewatch them all?
Oh, yeah. I think since the season got over with back in January, December, I probably watched it twice already. So
perfect.
Chomping at the bit, ready for season two. And yeah, I thought the recap really touched on a lot of it and really trying to find out the backstory with Moff Gideon and all this. So I'm ready for that.
Yeah. How about you, Jason? Did you rewatch them all?
I've watched the first season three times now.
There we go. Yeah. Yeah. We didn't need the recap, but it was cool to have.
What's funny though is I remember I watched the recap, but I've gone memento. I couldn't tell you what was in the recap.
It was basically them telling about you're now a tribe of two and you have to take this baby to its rightful parents.
People of its own kind or whatever.
Yeah, people of its own kind. Yeah, that's basically what the recap was. Nothing too earth shattering. So we start off with the Mandalorian walking into town. I thought it was weird. He's walking in the dark and there's nothing really around him. And he gets into the light and he's walking through town and you see all this graffiti on the walls and all that. And there's all these red eyes watching him on either side of the street, staying in the dark. And we'll get back to that part. Did you catch it the first watching the red eyes?
I hadn't. I was paying too much attention to the graffiti itself.
Same here. Yeah. On the rewatch, I caught the red eyes. Scott, did you?
Yeah, I noticed the red eyes, but I didn't I didn't put too much thought into it. I noticed it. I was like, oh, all right, you know, but not too much thought into it.
Yeah, yeah. Jason?
I got the red eyes right away, but I was also looking at the graffiti because I was looking for anything Sabine Wren in that graffiti.
Yeah, and you notice anything that was Empire in the graffiti, like there'd be stormtroopers and it'd be the big X paste. You know, through the stormtrooper, and then if there's like a C-3PO type character, it was untouched, and then there'd be like another stormtrooper, it'd be a big X through it, and then there was a Death Star, and somebody made like explosions around it. They touched up the graffiti after it was graffitied. So he goes to this bar. He has the baby with him. He goes. What was it? Gore Koresh. How do you pronounce the name?
Gore Koresh.
And he says, "I'm here to see Gore." Gorkarosh. I can't pronounce names. and there's two gun-guns having an axe battle. And that was kind of like I'm kind of glad that all the stuff that they teased us with, the vast majority of it is in this episode. I mean, other than the X-Wings, I think we got to see the gun-guns already right off the hop. So he's looking for Mandalorians. He wants to return the baby like he's supposed to, but I didn't understand why does he need help of other Mandalorians?
Well, okay, so what he's trying to do is the Mandalorians are kind of scattered around,
right,
in coverts, kind of like his tribe was, mm-hmm, on Navarro. So he's trying to find them to find the next one and such, and to try to find where someone who's maybe knows where the child's people are from.
Yeah.
So he's trying to follow the path of the Mandalorian coverts.
Yeah. Why does he need Mandalorians to help him find the child? Why doesn't he get Weegways or get Greedo characters or Hammerhead characters to help him? Why does it have to be a Mandalorian that helps him find where the Baby Yodas go? They don't know where the Baby Yoda's from. You know what I mean?
Well, they do. I mean, if you find the right group, but I guess I'm not sure. Exactly. Like you say, I'm not sure why he is so certain that they would be able to point him in that direction.
Yeah. Yeah. It just didn't make sense to me, you know? So of course it turns out, go ahead, Scott.
Also, did you know who the celebrity actor was that played Gorkarosh?
Yeah. John, I can't pronounce.
Leguizamo.
Yeah. Yep. Now I know him as a stand-up comedian. Has he done other stuff?
He's been in a lot of different movies and such as well.
His best role is still Chichi Rodriguez in Tu Wong Fu.
I was trying to remember. Was that the one, Tu Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything?
Yeah, where they all did drag.
Yeah. I remember seeing that way back in the day, and I thought he did a really good job in that movie. I mean,
has he been in any Star Wars, Marvel, Pixar, Indiana Jones movies, Disney? Yeah, because I already know him. I've seen him as a stand-up comedian plenty of times on different specials or whatever. So of course this guy here, he's just looking to set him up. I'm not sure how he's figured this guy was going to help him for free. Well, he was willing to pay for the information. He heard that this guy knew where it was Mandalorians. It turns out he's a Baskar collector or trader. He's not interested in helping Mando at all. He just wants to get the armor, whether he has to rip it from his dead body or or whatever. I thought that was interesting. He ends up shooting one of the gun-guns. Or not the gun-guns, the Gamorreans.
The Gamorreans, yeah.
Yeah.
Gamorreans, yep.
Yeah. And like nearly everyone around him had blasters and all that. Like, why don't they have people turn in their blasters before they get into this room? It has happened in other Star Wars universes where they have to drop off their blasters before they go in. I don't know.
I don't know. Maybe this guy is a bit more in charge of the place or something as well. So
okay, yeah. Well, they let Mando walk in with all his weapons.
True.
That just felt very Wild West in space.
Yeah, 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 I guess so. Some people, they just don't plan ahead. And we get to see the whistling birds again.
Now, I did like the child's reaction when Mando starts firing up his whistling birds. The kid knows what's coming, and he closes his little hover pram cover and hides.
Okay, I wanted to talk about that because, so it was also in the trailer where the child, or Baby Yoda, whatever you want to call him, he reaches around the front and pushes a button on the front of his hammock or whatever. There was a name for it. They actually named it. I can't remember what it was.
And I call it hover pram.
Yeah, the hover pram. And it closes up. In season one, this is the same one that Quill remade for him, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So in season one, the button was near the bottom. Go back and watch season one. Every time he closes it, the one that Quill made for the first one that he had, the button was in the front. The other ones, the button was kind of near the bottom of the egg-shaped thing. And maybe it's a two-way switch. Maybe it's on the bottom and one in the front. But I noticed that right away. I thought, wow, this one closes differently than it did last week.
Well, maybe Quill built in a little extra redundancy. You know, that's always good engineering.
Yeah. It could be a two-way switch. That's the only thing I could think of. But it's definitely, he closes it in a different spot.
Now, I do got a question. How many times is Mando filling up his whistling birds? I thought he almost used them all in the last season. And
right.
Does he have an infinite supply of whistling birds?
Well, and the armorer said, use these very sparingly because they're rare. Yeah. He uses them like 15 minutes later, and he's using them again. Jason?
Yeah, and it seemed like he had a full complement again this time.
Yeah. You're watching Mandalorian is kind of like playing a video game where he kind of gets bonus points and he gets better armor and he gets more better armor and he gets a backpack. He gets the whistling birds as he achieves more challenges, he gets more
equipment. Picks up little loot boxes as he goes along. He's got some microtransactions.
It's a lot like playing a video game. The hand-to-hand battle that happens after that, I was so proud of him that he didn't use his grappling hook at all.
But he did use the vibro blade that we saw him use to take down the Mudhorn last season.
Yes.
And I love the sound effects when they were hitting him in the head. And it was like a pot hitting a ladle, or ladle hitting a pot, a dung sound.
I had to question the intelligence of that. I mean, why are you hitting him in his helmet? You know that's going to hurt, right?
Oh, yeah, the guy hit him in the helmet and the head ricocheted and hit that other guy in the face.
Yeah, so Mando just has to sit there and go, all right, you guys beat me up and I'll basically take you out that way.
he was doing that, I thought, well, this is like when they run out of bullets until the gun at Superman.
Yes,
exactly. It's not going to work, but it's all you've got.
Yeah, exactly. They obviously never watched Karate Kid, because if they did, it would have swept the leg and then it would have got him. But I love the sound effect. I just pictured the foily guy sitting there with a pot and a pan, bing, bing, every time his head gets hit.
And we see another Zabrak. I said, we see another Zabrak, one of Darth Maul's people,
mm-hmm.
is one of the fighters.
It's always cool to see. So Gore runs away. Mando grabs his blaster after cleaning out the room and takes off after him. Uses his cable. I was thinking the first battle ever he didn't use his cable, and here he goes uses it right after. I was like, oh, he used it.
Yeah, I think he had to though, just to try to get some information.
It's way easier than running after. Made sense. It's where you use it and running after. He uses that move a lot, where he shoots somebody with the cable and then pulls them closer to him and then hits them, or hits them into something. He does that move a lot. But yeah, it was cool that he used it there. So when he says to Gore, I promise you will not die by my hand.
It was one of those threats that is so oddly specific. You kind of know something else is going to take this guy down.
As soon as he said that, I went, okay, well, those are Chekhov's red eyes, because they're coming back.
Well, exactly. Go ahead, Scott.
Yeah, exactly. When he said that, you knew the red eyes were coming into place, because he shot that light pole out. And
Yeah. It was kind of like, well, yeah, but you're still going to kill him. Like, you're going to be the reason he dies. We all know that. So he says there's a Mandalorian on Tatooine. And I'm assuming everybody thought the same thing. There's only one person that we know of that's a Mandalorian that's been on Tatooine in the past.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not a fan of Boba Fett having survived the Sarlacc pit. I think it happens a bit too much in Star Wars, where people die and they come back.
Just about any long running franchise, you start running into some of that.
Yeah, you do.
You can say the same thing about the Marvel movies. You can say it about.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But I was kind of like, well, Boba Fett should be dead. He shouldn't be. And I was like, they're bringing him back. Like, I thought it was just going to be, a Dave Filoni mislead by saying Boba Fett was coming back. Jason?
Can I just say something really quick about that? Because if Boba Fett is coming back, for me, he stopped being cool after Return of the Jedi, because the way he went out, It was so simple. He was this really cool, menacing threat all the way through Empire, then up to Jedi. And then he just kind of stopped being cool. So if they're bringing him back, I hope they redeem him so that he's not uncool for me anymore.
Yeah.
Well, I agree with you, Jason. Yeah, he's supposed to be this badass bounty hunter. And when he gets hit in the back by a blind Han Solo and he flies right into the Sarlacc pit, you know, you got a jetpack on. Why don't you try to fly out or something like that? I agree. I think there's going to be some...
Oh, it was his jetpack that was malfunctioning. That's what happened. And then he got in there.
It was just such a lazy way to kill that character off who was supposed to be so cool. So please, if you're going to do it, redeem this character. Make him the cool badass that we're supposed to think he is.
You know, I kind of imagine that someone like Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni have something like that in mind.
Yeah.
They want this guy to be cool.
I think you could be right. You could very well. I think that I agree with that. I think that we haven't seen, as much as I thought we saw the last of him in Jedi, I don't think we've seen the last of Boba Fett, but we'll get into that. So we get to Tatooine, and what's her name?
Peli Motto.
Yes. I was so happy to see her again. Were you guys?
I really was. And actually, I feel like the actress did a better job with the character this time. something just, it felt a little off for me last season. But this season, this episode, I thought she was spot on the whole way through. I really enjoyed her character that much more.
I find her character to be us. Like, she's like a fan. Almost in that, like, she's like, oh, I'm so happy, Mandel, you're back. I'm so that she sees Baby Yoda. Thank the Force, he's back. He's still alive. I'll buy him off you. Do you want to sell him? And she goes, kidding, not kidding. if you get another one,
I'm kidding, not really. But yeah, I'm always like, but not really.
she's one of us.
They're not cheap. Anyone can have one. See, I have one.
Yeah.
All right, listeners, take a good look at Jason's toy.
Yeah.
The pit droids go to fix the Razor Crest, and she stole my line. Sorry, gang, she yells.
And she's like telling the pit droids, "Don't go over there."
He doesn't like droids, and he's like, let him take a look at it. Oh, he likes droids now. Okay.
Yeah, so I guess the IG-11 turned him around?
Little bit, I think. I think at least somewhat. He still seems a little skeptical, and you should be skeptical of those pit droids.
Yeah. Jason?
I just love seeing the pit droids in general. I love seeing anything prequels anytime they get a cameo.
Yeah,
anything from the prequels.
Well, I enjoy the pit droids because they have that whole sort of Three Stooges shtick going on.
yeah. And then she calls over R5. It's kind of like one of our first major Easter eggs.
R5, yeah. D4.
Yeah, yes, what did
I think, D4? I think Favreau himself.
Go ahead, Jason, sorry.
I think Favreau himself confirmed that is... Indeed, the same R5-D4 that we saw in A New Hope with the bad motivator.
Right. So the motivator's still leaking. If you look close, you can see the one panel, there's oil dripping out of it, grease dripping out of it.
See, I thought that was like burn marks from when it had exploded.
No, it looked like grease to me. What did you, okay. Jason?
Am I the only one who punched the air when he saw R5-D4? I just got way too happy at that cameo.
Well, we know what happens to him eventually. He ends up on with Cad Bane.
Yeah.
In the Rise of Resistance attraction. We see him there at Galaxy's Edge after what happens with R5 later.
And we did see him last season,
Hondo,
too.
You mean Hondo, right? Sorry,
Hondo. Right, you're right. Hondo, you're right.
Hondo.
But
we saw R5 last season, though, too. He was in the cantina.
Right. That's right, too. So I guess the question is nobody going to clean that oil, or is he just constantly leaking the motivator? It's been a long time, you know, since we first saw him.
It's like that oil leak in my Dodge. I just, you know, you just park it in the grass.
Yeah. So he, go ahead, Scott.
No, I'm good.
Oh, okay. You looked like you're going to say something. So he asks her for, he from the map, he finds out where this Mandalorian could possibly be. So he's going to head out there. She says, don't take your ship. They'll see you miles away. Which I don't get that. I mean, they're going to see him coming on a speeder bike. Or they're going to see him walking anyways. Like it's a no horse town, basically, or a one bantha town. Anytime a stranger comes to town, they're going to notice it, and he'll get there a lot quicker with the ship. But whatever, the ship needs to get repaired, so he goes to borrow a speeder bike, which begs the question, why does he not have a speeder bike on his Razor Crest?
You would think he would after all the walking he would do.
Yeah, he has room for it. Like,
I'm thinking storage, it's not like a bike you could fold in half or hang on the wall. It's
exactly.
A lot of real estate in the Razor Crest.
I don't get it. Get him.
Yes, but keep in mind, he also transported, what was it, 3 blurgs last season?
Right. Oh. Yeah. Yeah, he has room for it. Room
hidden there somewhere.
So, man, he'll buy a speeder bike for crying out loud. So, he takes off.
This is supposed to be the same speeder bike from last season again. So, again, you're getting a lot of callbacks to the Gunslinger episode from last season.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. So he meets up with the Tusken Raiders, and those are always fun. He has a little campfire sit-in with them. We knew from season one that he could talk to them. Nothing too spectacular happening in that scene, I don't think.
No, but it's some nice world building. They're not just savages who attack, that there's kind of a culture and a language, and these are people you could work with and have a conversation with.
Yeah. It kind of makes Anakin look more like a jerk from the prequels.
As if we needed more of that. I find their language a little interesting in that it seems to be both vocalizations and hand gestures together.
Yeah, you're right. It is interesting. So he gets to the town, and he goes into the bar first, because that's what you do when you get into a Western town, is you go into the bar first.
Every Western town.
Yep.
Yeah. The whole entrance of him coming in slowly, kind of seeing the people looking at him cautiously and everything. I mean, it's right out of every Western ever. So we're getting that strong Western vibe again. Like we had in the Gunslinger last season, which was also on Tatooine.
Yeah.
Yeah. He has that John Wayne walk to him as he's walking in there.
Yeah.
I was surprised the tumbleweed didn't kind of just roll through the town.
Yeah, exactly. We got to see some womp rats when he got into town. But yeah, you're right.
Those are womp rats. I think they're called scurriers is what I was looking up. The womp rats look a little different from the pictures I was finding.
Oh, okay. I just figured there was different types of different species of womp rats, kind of like different species of frogs. sort of what I was thinking. They look similar but different. So he goes into the bar and has a weekly barkeep. And I like how he's looking. And the other thing, too, is I really liked about this show was this episode is they're like, Baby Yoda is like the big hit of the show. And it didn't become the Baby Yoda show, at least not in this episode anyways.
And that's my number one complaint about the episode. Not enough Baby Yoda.
See, I liked it. Yeah,
all the way through. All the way through. The child was like there. He was present. But other than the occasional reaction shot, there was nothing about him.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, all he had, exactly. The reaction shot, his expression, and that was it.
Yeah.
You know, there were some times where you thought he could have jumped in and did some, but I'm glad he didn't.
Yeah, you know? I agree. I'm glad he didn't. And he leaves the baby in the saddlebag and goes in. Go ahead, Justin.
One thing I noticed about Baby Yoda's reactions is from the very beginning when we saw him, it was kind of like, all right, I'm used to this now. This is life.
Yeah.
He wasn't shocked or scared by anything. He just kind of has this down now.
Well, he says he's seen a lot worse than the two Gamorreans fighting in a ring. So somehow he gets out of the saddlebag. I'm guessing he just fell on his head and then got up and walked into the bar because he appears in the bar. And
we don't know. He might use the force to just sort of levitate himself down, you know.
It's more funny thinking of him falling out of the saddle. I like how he's hanging out with what is that, a spittoon that the baby Yoda, the child's hanging out with?
That's what it sure looked like to me.
Yeah. I think it was a Splatoon. And you know, as soon as you saw that, he's going to end up inside that thing. It was, and I haven't been to the Disney store yet, but are they selling the Baby Yoda action figure with Splatoon yet? I'm sure that's going to be coming out. That's going to be coming out for this week sometime. So he says, hey, I'm looking for Mandalorian. And he goes, what does he look like?
Like someone me. Who looks like me.
Yeah.
He goes, oh, you mean the marshal? So, of course, the marshal's there. Someone, one of the townsfolk went running to get the marshal right away, saying there's a stranger in town that looks like you. Now, I was kind of like, crap, baby, Boba Fett's back. I didn't want Boba Fett to be back. I wanted Boba Fett to be dead. Dead is dead. That's why I look at it. So I was kind of like, oh, man. So he orders some. Now, that blue liquid he orders, was that from season one?
Yes, yeah. That is the spatchka from Sorgan.
Yes.
From the krill on Sorgan, yeah.
Exactly. And so he takes his helmet off, and as soon as he took his helmet off, I knew it wasn't Boba Fett. I'm like, all right, this isn't Boba Fett. It's somebody just wearing Boba Fett's armor. I was happy. I was a happy Stanley. And he puts the helmet down. And you can see the surprise on Mando's face through the mask. Took his mask off. What the hell is this? Who is this guy?
And it is amazing. It says something good about whoever is inside that armor, how well they can convey that, all these expressions with behind the mask.
Yeah. Oh yeah, for sure.
Because that's not Pedro Pascal playing the part.
You know, I think last season he wasn't in the armor as much. I think he's supposed to be in the armor personally a lot more this season. Okay. Is what I had heard.
Well, I thought any like close-ups, any like walking around was him, but I thought any like the battle scenes were stunt actors was, I could be wrong.
And you're going to find that, you know, pretty much across the board. But I think, yeah, I think a lot of stuff, if they don't need the actor to be present on set, a lot of times they'll have someone else take over the part. So I think that's probably the case here as well. I mean, and because you don't see the actor's face so much of the time, it could be anyone in there.
Yeah, yeah. So they have a little standoff. It doesn't last very long because they hear some rumbling, and they go outside and you see the sand moving. And now, did any of you think that was a kite dragon right away, or what did you assume it was?
I did not know what that was right off the bat.
I thought it was sand sharks for some reason. Because you see the fins going.
Justin, if there's anything it reminded me of, it was more like the sandworms from Dune.
That's what, yeah, I was about to say. As soon as I saw that, I went, the spice is the way.
Yeah.
The spice must flow. Yeah.
So he says, you know what, I think we can work out a deal. I thought that was a good line. So they make a deal, and he says, you know what, I'll go back, get my ship, I'll come back, I'll blow it up, easy peasy. Why didn't he do that with the AT-ST in the last season? Just go back, get your ship, blow up the AT-ST, then that would have been the end of the
Well, I think there he was really trying to keep such a low profile. He didn't want to be flying the ship around. He was hiding the number.
Yeah, I agree. I think he wants to be in hiding, and his ship is like his calling card at this point. You know, they see the ship, then that's going to bring more attention towards them.
Yeah, could be. So they take off. He goes, yeah, I know where it is. It's not far. It's like 2-day drive. It's like Toronto's not far from me. It's a 2-day drive or 3-day. But anyway, so they take off on their speeder bikes, and then we get to see the pod racer bike. Now, is that Anakin's pod racer or just the same model?
From what I read, they say that's Anakin's pod racer or part of it.
And I've seen it both ways. I've seen people saying that, yeah, it's absolutely Anakin's, and other people saying, well, this one's more red and Anakin's was more yellow, and so maybe it was just the same.
Well, Anakin's was kind of just engine parts with yellow fins. And this one is like yellow fins with kind of like a red covering over the engine parts, which I think you would want if you're going to be riding right beside it, as some kind of cover to put over top of the engine part.
Yeah, so I'm
it could be either way, but I think we're supposed to think of Anakin's pod racer when we see it, basically, whether it's supposed to be that exact one or not.
Jason, you're chomping at the bit. You got something to say? Oh, he's frozen. He's freezing up.
Okay.
Yeah, he's freezing up. Get you back now.
Okay.
Did you have something to say about Anakin's pod racer?
My thought was the same as yours. I just thought it was like the same make and model, just supposed to make us think of Anakin, but not be the same one. Because it's been, what, 30 years since that pod race?
Well, it's probably been longer than that, I would think. I would say probably almost 50 years.
Yeah.
Right, because this is...
Yeah,
this
you're right.
Yeah, because this is after episode 6. So, yeah.
So he has Anakin's Model T. And he's driving through the desert with it. It seems unlikely to me that that would be the same one. I think it's the same make and model. You know, it just seems weird. And that, you know, it bugged me. This would bug me a lot in this show. And I've watched the episode a couple of times, the chapter. His talking about while they're driving through the desert. And he's just talking normal. So you got the wind blowing at you. What are they going? Like 80, 90, 100 miles an hour with these speeder bikes. Django has a helmet on. And he's talking like they're talking like as if they're in a car. Just they've got the wind blowing. And he's telling the story of about whatever it was he was talking about. And it was too clear. Was that my crazy?
That's where I apply hand wavium.
Hand wavium. Which hand wavium?
Suspension of disbelief, Stan.
Maybe Yoda made a force bubble around him so that it was like they were inside a car and they could talk to each other like that without any problems. It was weird.
It's just kind of a common trope in a lot of TV shows. But yeah. So we start to get Cobb's backstory. Cobb Vanth.
Yeah, so he talks about how
It was the mining collective came in and took over the town and turned it into a slave camp almost immediately after the events of Return of the Jedi.
Right.
Now, when we see that little Death Star explosion, there's a bit of airbrush around the bottom, kind of in a circle. Turns out, if you translate that, it's part of the opening crawl text from Return of the Jedi.
So they're basically watching Instagram, and they got it. They keep seeing the Death Star blowing up over and over again. It's the loop on Instagram.
Facebook Live.
Yes, Facebook Live.
It was the hollow.
Real quick, that was another part of world. Another bit of world building I really liked was seeing as soon as the government collapsed, the militias came in.
Mm-hmm.
It was kind of nice to see that in Star Wars, as opposed to the Death Star's over. It's all over. Everyone's happy. Oh no! Now crap gets real.
Yeah,
and we should maybe mention too that a lot of Cobb Vanth's backstory here that we learn in this episode was also revealed in the Aftermath series of books by Chuck Wendig, I think it is. So this is where some of that character and the city of Mos Pelgo even comes from.
Okay, so that's awesome.
Cool. Yeah, I had to go back to my notes for the Gunslinger last season, and I had a lot of this written down as notes because that was one of the characters that was speculated to be potentially the person walking up on Fennec Shand's body at the end, because he would have been someone who was on Tatooine and supposedly had Boba Fett's armor.
So the miners come in and they start shooting everybody. So he takes off. He says, "I took what I could. I grabbed a Camtone."
The Camtono returns.
Yes. So now we got a name for it. The ice cream maker has a name. I don't know why he didn't take the speeder bike. That would have been a lot easier to take off with than running with a Camtone in your hands. He would have still had the Camtone. So he's wandering in the desert for a couple of days, no water, no food, carrying his ice cream maker. He could have made ice cream. It was in his hand. And he gets saved. He gets saved by the Jawas.
And apparently this is the first time it occurred to him to open that up and see what's inside. I mean,
yeah, well, maybe it was locked and the Jawas have, you know, their lock picking tools. They were able to unlock it. And there's crystals in there, and the Jawas want the crystals. So that's how he ends up with the Boba Fett armor, with the they make a deal. And they trade. So they come across these dogs. I recognize those dogs immediately from the prequels as being the Tusken Raiders dogs.
Yeah, they're called Massives. And they, yeah, and they first showed up in Attack of the Clones.
Yeah, yeah. So I was thinking the Tusken Raiders aren't going to be very far away. As soon as I saw those creatures, you guys get the same feeling, or
I just assumed so because we had already seen the Tusken Raiders so many times already, kind of foreshadowing that he can talk to them and is friendly with them again.
Yeah. I love the scene when they go to the camp and you see the sand person with the gaffy stick cleaning a bantha's teeth.
See, again, they're actually civilized.
Yeah, yeah. But
I loved how the Massives were changed almost immediately from like these snarling mean creatures to like just a friendly little puppy dog wanting to be petted.
Well, like
is wagging his tail.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very much like like dogs here on Earth. They could be very protective and they can also be very friendly and nice and loyal if you're, you know, the
that complete shift from like you're an enemy to oh you're my friend.
Yes.
It's like my dog. He barks at you at the door, but once you come inside, he loves you.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's what these creatures are very much like. What do you call them, Massive?
Massives, yep.
Massive.
M-A-S-S-I-F.
I did not know that. So they're sitting around the campfire. And they're finding out that they both have the same enemy. They want to get this kite dragon together. They're trying to come up with a plan. He grabs a rotten pumpkin, offers him to drink it.
Yeah, I was not able to find out what that is supposed to be called. I know everything in Star Wars universe has a name, but I couldn't figure out what that little fruit cup thing was supposed to be.
Yeah. Did anybody else? Go ahead, Jason.
Am I the only one who thought that was going to be like the space equivalent of a peace pipe?
Well, you know what? I went back.
They're just going to have a groovy campfire after that.
I was thinking Indiana Jones, where they got the monkey brains. And she goes, I'm not going to eat the monkey brains. And he goes, just eat it. You're embarrassing me and insulting them. There's the exact same line that they used from.
I immediately thought of that as well.
How about you, Scott?
I wouldn't have drank it. You open it up and a puff of smoke comes out of it, or I'd have been the same way.
But and you don't have that filter that the sand people have to get rid of all that stuff before it gets into you.
Yeah.
Around their neck. So they come with an agreement that they're going to work together. And get the kite dragon.
The other scene I thought of while we were watching this was when the two groups are arguing at each other and Mando has to break it up with the flamethrower was Monty Python and the Holy Grail when the father goes, let's not bicker and argue about who killed who.
Yes, for sure. So
Jason, did you have that same thought? You look like you were...
So I have written down here single file. the traveling in single file, the Tauntauns or the Banthas and the Sand People.
Absolutely. Every single time we see them traveling, they are in single file.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't notice that. I have to watch that the next time.
Yeah. Now that's great if they're coming towards you, but if you're seeing them in the distance from far away, it's like, wow, there's a lot of them in a single file. It's like, and I guess that's the equivalent to social distancing, seeing them walking in single file, 6 feet apart from each other.
And they're wearing masks.
And they're all wearing masks. Yeah. So COVID is alive and well on Tatooine in the Dune Seas.
That's what that was in that little plant thing that smoked out that drink.
That's COVID. So he was smart not to have it. So the they got the little skeleton thing that the sand people set up a little. This is how we're going to get it, and they have like the little skull and the bones and chocolate chips. he has a couple of chocolate chips. Is that what that is?
They did look like chocolate chips. I'm not the only one who thought that.
Okay, good. I thought anyone had thought that too. I just said to my wife, those look like chocolate chips. Those are chocolate chips. So now in the legends of Star Wars, the way Tauntaun or the sand person, Tusken Raider becomes a man is they kill a kite dragon. And these sand people are afraid of this kite dragon and they want help killing it. And I kind of like, well, that takes care of that legend, Legends of Star Wars, and one of the stories, backstory. Well,
is it just that this one is, you know, particularly large and dangerous?
I was watching it, I'm thinking
the biggest one that they know of.
That's exactly it. So when I rewatched it a couple of times, I kind of got to thinking that, yeah, no, this is a larger than normal kite dragon. This one is huge. This one is something bigger than any. And that's when he's saying they're not that big. He goes, yeah, they're that big.
Well, go ahead, Jason.
Just to say, when he said it ate the Sarlacc, you knew they were in trouble.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So, Scott, were you going to say?
Yeah. The kite dragon was in the abandoned Sarlacc pit. So, yeah, you could tell that this is some big dude.
Right. So he says, well, we're going to, those extra chocolate chips are the villagers. We're going to incorporate the villagers to help us. So they head back to town again, and they have that village meeting. He says,
and again, let's not bicker and argue.
So they make a deal, and the sand people, they want the carcass and the ichor is what they want out of the deal for killing this kite dragon. And they promised to never attack the town again, unless one of the townspeople attacked the sand people again.
No, technically it was until one of you break the peace.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I remember commenting on that at the time, even going, until you're just, this is an when not if situation. Is this what you're saying?
yeah, exactly. Well, yeah. I think it's kind of the same meaning either way. So the sand people coming to town. I love the music that they had for the sound people coming to town.
I love the music all throughout this one.
Yeah, but it was kind of like an Arabian Nights type of sounding. Did you catch on that at all, or was I the only one, Scott?
No, I think the score of this whole episode has been great. You know, okay. Music and all that, but
okay. So they're loading up the banthas with explosions in the village, and obviously these banthas are not like the original banthas where there's elephants inside costumes. I don't think that Lucasfilm didn't dare doing that.
They load up the one bantha in particular with all these explosives to carry them all out there. And we find out that they're explosives when one of the Tuskens accidentally drops one and tempers flare up a bit.
Yeah. So this is when Mandalorian, he's kind of telling the plan about what we're going to do is, well, the bottom of the belly is the weakest, and we're going to dig a hole, and we're going to put the explosives in there. We're going to have some bait and get the kite dragon to come out. We're going to hit the detonator and blow up the kite dragon. Who is he telling this to? he tells the entire plan as they're showing them doing this, but
he's telling the audience.
He's telling the audience.
Yes. This is one of those, you know, again, it's like, just TV show tropes or whatever, but yeah, that should have been that would have been explained long before they were loading up the panther with the explosives in the first place.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm watching this and I'm thinking to myself, who the heck is he telling this to? He's just talking to himself in the corner. Like, is this guy losing his mind or what's going on over here?
I just thought they needed a song under it. You could have had an old school montage.
Yeah.
There you go. But did you notice that one of the Banthas hands Cobb Banth one of those little fruit cup things to drink out of again? Mm-hmm. And this time he just drinks it without hesitation.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So the three Tusken Raiders go out and they're going to lay it, like basically call the Kite Dragon out. Now, the earlier in the show, we didn't talk about it, but they showed the example of the Tusken Raider going out to show kind of where the kite dragon was, and that Tusken Raider gets eaten rather than,
because he was offering up a bantha to the dragon,
yeah, so
the dragon would eat it and sleep longer,
right?
And instead, it comes out and eats the Tusken instead of the bantha,
right? So Mando witnessed that. Now they do this again, and this time they sent three Tusken Raiders out. Why didn't Mando take his speeder? And the marshal take their speeder and have a couple of Tusken Raiders on the back so they can bug out quicker. Like, so these three Tusken Raiders are running for their lives when this Kite Dragon comes out. And they're like, I don't have to run faster than the Kite Dragon. They have to run faster than the other two Tusken Raiders. But they're running for their lives to get out of there. It would have been so much, like, just hop on a speeder and bug out. Like, I didn't understand that. Anyways, the Kite Dragon starts roaring. Now, I meant to talk to you guys about this beforehand, and we didn't. But you're familiar with the special edition, the original trilogy, when Ben does a Kite Dragon howl to scare away the Tusken Raiders.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the special edition came out, they edited it to make it a different howl. Mm-hmm. And then I think it was when the Blu-ray came out, they edited it again to make it a third different howl. I was very much listening to the Kite Dragon's roar to see which one they were going to use that Ben used in New Hope and the three different versions. So did you guys
I think it's more reminiscent of the first one.
What's that?
I thought it was supposed to be more reminiscent of the original one.
Well, see, this is what's the thing. When the Kite Dragon first wakes up, and he starts roaring inside the cave, it sounds very much like the first one, like A New Hope, the original theatrical release. And then later on, when we hear the Kite Dragon attacking, it has more of a whistle howl sound to it, which sounds more like the Blu-ray release. So both of them are accurate, is what I think Filoni and Favreau were doing, kind of like, well, you guys can stop arguing about it because they both sound like Kite Dragons. Just one is attacking, one is kind of like just waking up howl.
Well, and we did hear this howl last season too, if you remember, in The Gunslinger, when baby Yoda wakes up all alone in the ship, he makes the sound of a Kite Dragon, and that's how Pelimoto goes in and finds him.
Okay, I don't remember that at all.
That's what alerts her to his presence.
Okay, I don't remember that at all. So the battle at the Kite Dragon ensues. The explosives weren't strong enough,
which is a bad sign.
Yeah. any thoughts on we all knew that in the end Mando would be the one to be taking it down, or Yoda.
Yeah, and I think that's what I thought, you know, going into it, that they weren't going to be able to do what they were going to do with the explosions, and the child wasn't going to go use the force to either pull the dragon out farther or actually kill it. That was my interpretation. That's what I thought was going to happen.
Yeah.
And again, another TV show sort of basic trope is like, whenever they lay out the plan, this is exactly what's going to happen. That's exactly what's not going to happen.
Yeah. So when Mando was telling us the plan, he goes, okay, here's the plan. It's not going to work. Jason,
so yeah, that was Chekhov's bantha for me, because once I saw the bantha wrapped in explosives, I went, well, that's how they're going to kill it.
Yeah, exactly. So it was really cool, though. I thought the effects were phenomenal in this entire sequence. I thought the sound, everything was great. And so Mando, he uses the same move that Han did to Boba Fett, hitting the jetpack.
Yep.
to get him to take,
causing it to malfunction and fly him away.
Yeah. So the problem's not Boba Fett. The problem is the design of the jetpack. That's the problem. It's not Boba Fett's fault. It was the it's a jetpack.
Boba Fett is still cool. It's just his backpack is malfunctioning.
Yeah. He needs to take that on switch and put it somewhere else.
Yeah, exactly.
Right on the back.
Like the Rocketeer, where it's in his palm.
Well, yeah, or somewhere else. Yeah, it was just like you just tap that thing and it takes off.
Real quick. I noticed when they got outside, the Boba Fett armor started lighting up panel.
Mm-hmm.
Am I the only one that noticed, like, it just kind of started coming on out of nowhere after being off for the first half?
I noticed it more in the meeting with the townsfolk that he had like lights on there. And I'm like, yeah, it just seemed like really obvious, especially standing right next to the Mando who doesn't have those lights.
Yeah, because yeah, I don't think it was going when he first walked in at the very beginning with...
I don't think so either.
Yeah, they just kind of seemed to come on halfway through and then stay on.
Yeah, what were the purpose of those lights? Do any of you know?
I haven't got a clue. I'm guessing it's like...
Maybe it means the backpack is activated? I don't know.
Fully charged?
Yeah.
But it's like beating almost, like a heartbeat or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like half the features of my Apple Watch. I have no idea what they do. So he ends up enticing the kite dragon to swallow him whole, along with the bantha filled with explosives.
Technically, I don't think he intended to be swallowed with the bantha. The bantha tried to run away, and he had to hold it there.
Okay,
I think he intended to get the thing to eat the bantha, but he was planning to fly off, but then he couldn't.
Yeah, he couldn't because he was holding on to the bantha rope. You're right. It kind of shows a lot of like how much the Mando has grown in the past two seasons. He hated droids. Now he's okay with droids. That's kind of like a growth in the character. He couldn't take on a mudhorn by himself without Yoda's help in the first season. And now he's battling a kite dragon on his own, coming with ways to destroy it. He's grown a lot as a character, which is great. So the kite dragon blew up, and to quote SCTV, he blew up good. He blew up really good. There is no dispute whether it worked this time or not.
But and, just talking before that too, I thought it was like really fascinating to see this creature coming like up out of the mountain and then disappearing and coming up out of the sand and whatnot. It really showed the versatility and danger of this creature.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. And he bit mountains like nothing. Like he so the raiders got their carcass. And they find the pearl or the ichor. And again, from the Legend series, the Legend stories is the kite dragon pearl was tiny. Like they would use them inside lightsabers as a focusing point, or they would be
only.
They would...
I think that's only if there was a kyber crystal involved. Because there's, and maybe the size of the pearl depends on the size of the creature.
Exactly. So that's what we were saying earlier. And that kind of debunks my theory about them debunking the legends, which I kind of originally thought was because if legend stories were that the sand people could kill a kite dragon to become a man. Now the pearl is bigger than, you know why? Because this kite dragon's bigger than normal. That's why.
But yeah, the pearl is created from, you know, basically that they have to swallow rocks and such to help with their digestion. And that, you know, the same way, you know, pearls get created in real life. But the idea was that if that sort of initial rock was a kyber crystal, then it would be something that you could use in a lightsaber.
Yes, exactly. But that's what I mean. Like they were tiny, like they would fit inside a lightsaber. Yeah. This thing's huge. This is the size of a beach ball.
You know. Which means, considering how rare and valuable these things are supposed to be, that thing has got to be just absolutely priceless if it's that large.
Yeah, what did the Tusken Raiders want with them?
Well, when he held it up and yelled in Tusken, I went to go to the pawn shop.
Exactly, we're gonna go to that. Exactly, and I love how he held it up and yelled. It was very reminiscent to, like, that's how they sound. That's a celebration that Tusken Raiders do. They hold their hands up, go, that's how they celebrate. So Mando loads up a big hunk of the carcass on the back of his speeder bike, takes Yoda, and now he gets the armor back from the Marshal. Did anybody think he was going to leave it for the Marshal?
No.
No.
Justin?
That is not the way.
I felt like he was going to take it, but I did like Cobb Vance line that it's like, you tell your people that I didn't break that. Yeah. I assume he's talking about the jetpack that keeps going off.
Well, either the jetpack or the dent in the helmet, one or the other. But yeah, I thought at the beginning when they made that deal, I thought he was going to leave it with him. But kind of at the end there, when he was giving it to him, I thought, no, he's going to take it. I felt that he would have been, you know, like the Marshal kind of needs it in this town. He needs the armor.
Well, when the Marshal specifically says, you know, I hope we cross paths again, I was reminded of when Cara Dune said something similar last season. And then sure enough, they cross paths again. So I'm kind of expecting Cobb Vanth to return and probably get his armor back then.
Could very well be. So he literally drives off into the sunsets in the ending, and we get a mysterious figure watching him from a cliff.
Okay, and a little nerdy thing here, I just have to say, the ratio of the screen changed at that point. It becomes slightly more cinematic. It became a little more widescreen, which I thought was kind of an interesting touch as well.
Yes. Yeah. Great shots. So who's the actor again?
Temuera Morrison? T-E-M-E-U-R-A. Temuera.
Right. Who, of course, played Jango Fett in Attack of the Clones. So...
he also has voiced Boba Fett in several video games.
Right. So it's Boba Fett. The IMD page says it was Boba Fett. I think we can all pretty much agree that Boba Fett's back, as much as I thought Dead was dead. Anyone disagree?
I'm just curious as to why he doesn't have his own armor then, if he did manage to get out of the Sarlacc pit.
Well, yeah. So we got a backstory to get. That's for sure. And
we know that Jawas are thieves.
Well,
they probably rolled in the left.
They're probably not going to take on a Mandalorian to steal his armor successfully.
I kind of had this vision in my head where Boba Fett gets out, he's weak, he's tired, he passes out, and they just rob him and roll in the desert.
Well, they're not really thieves. They're more like scavengers and traders. I don't think they would literally pick your pocket or strip your armor off you. I think that they would be. Like, they do have a little bit of honor because, like, they wouldn't, you know, I mean, like, they rescued the Marshal and they traded him for his crystals as opposed to saying, "Well, these are ours now, goodbye." They do have an honor system, the Jawas. So that is a backstory. Now, the Boba Fett is watching him from the cliff, and he has a Tusken Raider gaffy stick and a Tusken Raider rifle with him. Is he part of a Tusken Raider clan now? Or is he... that's what you use in Tatooine.
Yeah, Silent. Or maybe he managed to get some stuff off of a Tusken Raider somehow or other, but...
Yeah, yeah. Now, Scott, I'm going to ask you this. So he's watching Boba Fett, or watching the Mandalorian go by on his speeder bike. What does he want back? Does he want Baby Yoda, or does he want his armor?
I think that's a good question. I would have to say it's probably his armor.
Yeah.
But then, you know, it could be maybe he's out for the child too.
Is he still a bounty hunter, just not a Mandalorian bounty hunter?
And I think he might be just the bounty hunter. Now he might go after the child.
Well, we know he hates Jedi. So if he knows that the child has force capabilities, he might be just upset about that enough to want to kill him.
You know what? I agree. I think he's after the child because he could have always got his armor back if he's been on tattooing with the Marshal having it, or Cobb having it. So he could have always have gotten that back. I think he's out for the child.
What do you think, Jason?
I'm thinking Scott might be right there, where he may have just gotten out of the pit and given up the identity of Boba Fett and maybe somebody else now. But yeah, he's after the child for sure. As soon as they started saying Boba Fett's coming into this, you knew it was going to be we just kind of know it's going to be a fight between Mando and Boba versus for the child.
Yeah. It could be too that he lost his armor he took his helmet off. Somebody saw him. He goes, "Okay, I'm no longer a Mandalorian. Someone saw my head. Someone saw my face," and discarded his armor.
Well, and that being said, he could have traded his armor with the Jawas for something to survive.
Yeah, yeah. For a gaffy stick and a rifle, and a cloak.
But yeah, he realized his jetpack was defective, so he didn't want it no more.
Yeah, but in any event, it was a cliffhanger, that's for sure. So we're going to wrap it up with that. What's next week's episode? Did anybody look it up?
I did not.
I did, but I can't remember. No? Okay. Well, we'll be back next week. Same Mandalorian time, same Mandalorian channel. Any final thoughts? So we'll go around. Justin?
Mostly, I did want to say I liked how all of the callbacks of this episode made the gunslinger seem a little less like frivolous filler from last season.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like that feels more like setup now instead of just filler and fan service.
Yeah. Jason?
What I liked was this wasn't like the traditional bag opener. It was a nice steady pace. It was a talky episode. And even though it was 55 minutes, it felt like 5 minutes.
Yes.
I didn't like not having enough Baby Yoda. And I have spoken.
See, I like it that they didn't have Baby Yoda. I like it that he hasn't taken over the show. Scott?
No, I kind of agree with all you guys on your take on it. I like how parts of the first season with the callbacks on the characters and everything, it's just building into a bigger story. And I'm looking forward to this season going forward and all the other callbacks from last season.
Yeah. And again, like, I love the Easter eggs, but I don't love them overwhelming us. And I think it makes the universe feel almost small when you got Anakin's pod racer and R5-D4. And, you know, it just seems to be, I don't know, over.
That said, I do really like the callbacks to the show itself. So like the Spotchka and things like that.
Yes.
That references that were introduced in this show. It makes that feel like this is a more coherent universe in and of itself.
Well, and I like how they're bringing some other characters back, like with Pelimoto. And if you're going back to the same planet, you want to be familiar with who was on it and who you can trust, and like that with Cara Dune and stuff like that. I'm sure she's coming up in some future episodes. So I like how that.
Exactly. So we'll see you all next week. Ken, I have spoken.
If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tours Magical Ticket Holders. While you're on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tours. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tours Podcast, as well as on Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour. If you would like to email us, drop us a line at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcast. Only one rule, make it good. All logos, sounds, songs, and music that are made by and for Disney and its affiliates are the full ownership of the Disney Corporation and are not, nor are they intended to be, the ownership of the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.
I have spoken.